confirm the acknowledgement of the indigenous people on whose stolen land we meet here. Actually, it began outside with the tour that we were given by the muralists, so I'm not adding something new, I'm just reaffirming it. I really want to thank Diana and Brooke for putting this together. It's really, really important for us to think about the history in order for us to learn both about the oppression as well as the resilience and the resistance that's going on. I also want to thank the Freedom Archives, California Coalition for Women Prisoners, and the Women's Building and the National Women's Studies Association. I was here at the Women's Building only one time when there was an event for Petita Martinez. And it was a long time ago. And so all of this, it's beautiful. I'm going to take you up. I'm actually doing classes and organizing and so on. You will regret that you have said it, maybe not, okay? And give you a Puerto Rico Libre. We have connections actually with all the groups that have organized the Freedom Archives, California Coalition for Women Prisoners. We were involved in organizing the first U.S. Prisoner Solidarity Delegation to Palestine, National Women's Studies, and we have been working ever since and continue to work on all sorts of levels. National Women's Studies Association was actually an exemplary association. If it weren't for the Browning of NWSA, if it hasn't been for the meeting we had in Puerto Rico in 2014 and the support of Puerto Rican women freedom fighters, and if it hadn't been for the determination and for the work, the international solidarity, we would not have been able to pass a very strong resolution in support of Palestine as part of solidarity and support for justice. I was asked to speak. I was asked to speak about the panel is supposed to talk about the women's organizing in the Bay Area. So I wasn't in the Bay Area. I grew up under Israeli occupation, and I was mostly involved actually in New York City, in the base, first in Madison, Wisconsin, for 4 years, then in New York City in the 80s. But I do know some of the stuff that was going in the Bay Area that I would like to share. Some of you probably know about. The Bay Area was the home to the Palestine Solidarity Committee. I used to come every 3 months. I was on the National Executive Committee, and Hilton Obenzinger was one of our members of the, and he and other people, Steve Goldfield and Doug, were running something called Palestine Focus. We had a newsletter. And we used to organize, include many things, including the 1985 big tour of 26 Palestinians and people from the African National Congress, including the ANC Women's League and the Shaba Singers, a tour around the country in 26 cities called Israel and South Africa, the Apartheid Connection. The Palestine Solidarity Committee actually originally was called November 29th Coalition. November 29th Coalition, then we added Palestine, and November 29th Coalition was founded in 1981 to have the first biggest national demonstration in the US at the United Nations to mark the International Day of Solidarity with the Palestinian people, which also is the same day of the partition of Palestine in 1947. And in 1982, when Israel invaded Lebanon, there was a need for a continuous organization, and N29 continued to build this collaboration between Palestinian, Lebanese, and everybody else who was involved from all over the world. And I don't have time to get into it, but if you look at the first leaflet that November 29th put out, it has over 100 organizations signing it, including at the time the ambassador of Grenada, before Grenada was occupied by the US, ANC, SWAPO, FDR, FMLN, every single group that the Puerto Rico socialist movement, the American Indian movement, every movement you have, it's there. And that's another discussion which we can talk about, because the archive is really, really important source for us to learn and go back to. In the Bay Area, there was also another organization that I was connected to, but I was not part of here, called the Palestinian Women's Association. Palestinian Women's Association, 1979, was the first association in the US and Canada to be formed in the Bay Area. And it's not in record books. Nobody has talked about it. Even people who talk about the history of activism and organizing in the Bay Area do not mention it. But it was one of the most formidable organizations. I was involved with the New York part of it in 1983. And it's partly because actually we were not welcomed to many of the forms of the women's movement because we were supposed to be nationalist, not feminist. We did not have an organization, so we went and formed ourselves an organization, and we collaborated with many, specifically anti-imperialist, I mean really anti-imperialist women, indigenous women, women of color, actually who are the ones who welcomed us all over. And in 1986, we formed the Union of Palestinian Women's Associations in North America in Chicago. And Palestinian Women's Association in the Bay Area here was part of those associations. And we grew into 29 chapters in the US and Canada with 2,000 members that were actually real members. I mean, dues-paying members. And we changed the rules of our convention that anybody who comes to the convention can participate and vote, because we know how difficult it is for people to get to the convention and so on. I want to talk a little bit about why is it that we had this convention, why is it that Palestinian Women's Association came, what happened, what made it happen, and what are some of the things we did, and end up where we're at here today, very quickly. First is why. No, I'm going to try to be very quick. First is that I think it's really important to also keep in mind that organizations and community organizations do not come out of a vacuum. Many times people who follow what Todd Gitlin says, the whole wide world is watching. Actually, the whole wide world is not always watching, and it's always watching some things and not others. And some things end up in the books, and things don't end up in the books, and so on. But there is this always this moment of spontaneity. There is the Arab Revolutions 2011. There is the Palestinian Intifada. There is the uprisings in Chile right now. There is what's going on in Haiti. There is the stuff that happened in Puerto Rico. And there is no understanding by the hegemonic powers, or maybe they understand but they don't want to acknowledge, that this has been as a result of ongoing, very long-term organizing. And this was also the Palestinian Women's Association here, because this was the most recent episode at the time of what was happening also in Palestine. So there is always connection. And this, if people recall, this was around the time the conditions were being laid for the Palestinian Intifada of 1987. Not the first, wasn't the first one, but it is the Intifada of the Stones. And there was a lot of organizing going on by many, many groups. Was the most recent episode because Israel always crushed the movement and people rise and organize again. And this was at the time what was going on. For Palestinian Women's Association in Bay Area, one of the things that were very, very instrumental, and people know that in 1968 there was the longest student strike at San Francisco State University, led by the Black Student Union and the Third World Liberation Front. But one of the main organizations here that was actually collaborating, yeah, was the Arab Organization of Arab Students that was national, that was based everywhere, that was actually not made up of Arab Americans, it was made up of Arabs who came to study here and organize and were working very closely with the Iranian Student Association, with people who were opposing the war in Vietnam, with the people who were organizing for Black Panthers, for American Indian Women, for everybody else. And the members of PWA came out of the Organization of Arab Students, number one. They were very much influenced what was happening in the Bay Area, what was happening in the world. So it's really important for us to keep that kind of history there. Okay, then I have 2 minutes, so I'm going to rush through it. So how did it grow? I mentioned about the size of the organization. We had multiple activities. I'm going to just mention a couple. We had the family sponsorship program where we supported at least 100 families in Palestine to be steadfast under Israeli repression. We had conventions where we have featured former political prisoners, mothers of prisoners, speakers from all the movements. Every single movement that was present in the US came and spoke. In 1990, we organized the first feminist women's delegation to Palestine that was composed of Barbara Harlow, late Barbara Harlow, Ruthie Gilmore, Jane Powers, the widow of the late Jack O'Dell, the Alicia Portnoy, Angela Gillen, many, many others. And and one of the things that, and actually we actually nominated, and we got a woman from here, from the Bay Area, Umm Elias Abla Shamiyeh, to actually be a member of the Palestine National Council, the Palestine National Council, that part of the PLO. I mean, this took a lot of work, which we can talk about. And one of the things that were in support of us, and I really want to loop it back to what was happened in the beginning, that some of the support, and I just want to mention specifically, not everybody who has supported, because a lot of people have been supportive of Palestine, and when they tell you that there's a lot of support for Palestine everywhere. We're not allowed, we actually have the world with us. Just because some folks in the US dominant place think that they today discovered Palestine, it's been around for a very long time. And I really want to mention Miranda Bergman, because Miranda was the founder of the Break the Silence Mural Project. And during the 80s, Miranda and other feminist muralists went to Palestine and painted on the inside walls, because you could not paint on the outside, it was illegal, painted murals that we then got permission from them to print postcards for UPWA that enabled us to fund travel for women and their children to go to international conferences. Miranda also helped us design the t-shirt that we have for Sisters in Struggle that has that she actually went and got permission from the artist to do so. And if it wasn't for solidarity like that then, and for solidarity like this today, for NWSA, for the California Coalition for Women Prisoners, for QUIT, for the connection to the Gabrielle Network, for everybody, women in Puerto Rico who stood with us, we would not be here today. So we folded the union in 1995, but we still have the children and the grandchildren of the women who were involved in UPWA being today the leaders of the Palestinian youth movement, of the Palestinian student at San Francisco State, of the Palestinian, they're all grown up now, but every time I meet them, they call me Khalto, they call me auntie, that's okay. And they are the children of the women, the comrades that we struggled with day in and day out. So movements may fold at some point. We folded 1995 because of the Oslo Accord, but the impact continues. And if we are able to build on that impact, we definitely can have victory, and we can definitely defeat all the forces of injustice. Thank you.